We will start the day off with our music. Then I'll have Pastor Stevenson, if he is on still, do a prayer for us. And then we'll get to the sermon. Amen.
Amen.
There is a mommy.
Amen. Pastor Stevens, would you lead us in prayer? Thank you for that, Pastor. Today I thought we would look at some of our obligations. And if you look at us in this world, we have obligations on a whole lot of different areas. We have an obligation to work and provide, if only for self. We have an obligation to pay taxes even when we don't want to. We are obligated to a time of being awake and a time of sleeping. We have made material obligations, from buying a car that we can't afford and to showing off a house that we bought to please a man. And please don't leave out our own obligation of being braggadocious on whatever thing that we think that we can do well. And just one insight on that. We had a preacher bragging to his church this past week that they didn't deserve him because they could not afford him. We'll even put an obligation on a person based on our own so-called talents. So today I want to speak on the fleshly body and where the true obligation lies. Our scripture for today comes from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 10 through 12, and it simply reads, "But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of the Spirit who lives in you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. If I was titled today's sermon, it would be, "There is no fleshly obligation." The simple fact is, when we obligate ourselves in this world, we give a true effort to that obligation because we can see it, we can touch it, we can feel it, and we know it. We get up, we think about it, we work at it, and try to get better at it every day, and that is to even keep a job. You don't go to work and give the very bare minimum and expect to keep the job. The Lord said He would take the faith of a mustard seed as an effort from us, and we won't give Him that. But we'll do anything for the pleasure and upkeep of the flesh. See, the problem here is, for a true disciple of the Lord, is that the flesh is not who we are a slave to. The flesh is not supposed to be guiding our footsteps, and we don't walk in the flesh. So why do we continue to obligate ourselves to fleshly ways? Now, I must emphasize this word in verse 10, because it says, "But if." And this "if" is there because this makes the difference in your obligation. See, if you have Christ in you, then your flesh does not have a debt owed to it. But if Christ is in you, then you is not in you, then you have a debt in you that has already been paid. Jesus has already paid our debt. But you have to work for the service that was provided. See, the flesh has its own obligation. It can only pay out one wage or price for your obligation to it. If you look in Romans 6 and 23, it says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." See, you have to see that your payment for the obligation to the flesh is sin. And that means death. And your body that you lavish on in this world that goes against God in every manner, from lying to sexual immoral acts, from fashions to music, from deplorable to unholy, and from the pulpit to the alleys, continue to go against the Lord. The wages for this flesh and its adoration will be death. Now, if you look at verse 10, it starts off speaking about Christ, and as Romans 6 and 23, which I just read, shows you that Christ is the gift. And eternal life comes through Jesus the Christ and His righteousness. See, we don't need to concentrate on this flesh if we have Christ in us, because the flesh is not at the will, but the Spirit is at the will. You can tell who is driving because one is selfish and one is selfless. One is working in love and the other in iniquity. One is showing compassion and one is showing hatred. One is a backslider and may not know God at all. And one is on their knees and in their hearts repenting to the Lord. But truly, the one that is driving not only knows two great things, but lives these two great things. Matthew 22, 26 and 39 saith, "Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself." See, the flesh does not operate out of love. And remember that the flesh has acts. whereas the Spirit has fruits. The Lord told us to be fruitful and multiply because he had a way for us to do it. He did not say act away and multiply. He told us that the acts of the flesh are, but the fruits of the Spirit are. See, the flesh acts out and is a bad driver with no God-like ways. But the Spirit is obligated to the Lord and relishes the chance to please the Lord by obeying his ways. See, when you received the Holy Spirit, it was time to take off the slavery of sin and report to a higher calling. An obligation to walk in a different light. And yes, darkness is strong, but it can't overcome the light, nor can it walk through the light. But the light can not only walk through it, but it can overcome it, and the light has overcome the darkness. The stench of sin has been defeated, and you need Christ to do that. You need the Spirit of God in you and active to overcome this dark flesh that wants and craves what the world has to offer. And I reiterate, it is death and damnation. Who in their right mind would want two deaths? And the book of Revelation says that there are and will be two deaths. You are a follower of Jesus. Then why are you not willing to accept the standards of Christ? You know, when you hear, "Pastor, I can't do what I used to. I can't say what I used to say. And it was fun and I was noticed by everybody." See, that is a conversation that the flesh is putting on your spirit to get you to slip back into your wicked fleshly ways. But repent and be strong, because you do not have an obligation to the flesh. Your true obligation was, is, and will always be to the one that provided you salvation. To the one that allowed you to have the opportunity not to feel his wrath or to suffer the second death. And to the one that writes the names down in the book of life. This is not a wishy-washy obligation either. I'm not telling you this is going to be an easy walk. I'm not telling you that there aren't going to be some problems. I'm not telling you that there won't be some burdens. But your obligation is to the one that can lift those burdens. Your obligation is to the one that can walk with you and carry you at times. And your obligation is to the one that will tell you that this little bit of suffering is light. See, this is not going to be an easy thing for you to do because you live in the flesh. But if you are a believer, then you have the Holy Spirit in you. So please know that there is no division. The same Holy Spirit that is in me is the same Holy Spirit that is in you. And if I could put it another way, the same Holy Spirit that defeated death and snatched Jesus up is the same Holy Spirit that he left here for you. So are you willing to let him drive? If you let him drive, then he will surely show you the way to your obligation. The other thing is that you are being filled with the Holy Spirit constantly. I know some of you may say, "Well, Sunday I fill up with the Holy Spirit." But that is not enough, because that leaves 6 days for the flesh to fill you up. I know some of you say, "Sunday and Monday I fill up with the Holy Spirit." But you work in barbershop hours. And that's not enough, because the flesh still has 5 days to fill you up. See, you have an adversary out there that fills up the flesh any and every time that he gets an opportunity. The flesh is at you 366 days a year, 265 hours and there ain't but 24 in a day and 61 seconds in a minute, and you want to fill the spirit up for 8 hours, maybe 4 hours at church. You have to constantly be at work with the spirit because the flesh is warring with it constantly. And the word states that they are contrary one to the other. In other words, they don't get along. They don't like each other. See, you have to let Christ fill you up so that there is no room for the flesh to put anything in. See, we don't struggle to sin because we are in the flesh. We struggle to walk like Christ because we have not obligated ourselves to the Spirit. We should want to live according to the Spirit. Jesus is in you, so let Jesus be working in you. You claim Him, but you don't call on Him. You claim Him, but only in times of need. You claim Him, but only after you have failed. But I'm going to tell you to claim Him because you know that you will fail without Him. I'm telling you to claim Him because any and all times are a need for our Messiah, and praise Him and lift Him up even more in the good times because He has delivered you from a bad time. And look to Him for His deliverance. And stop crying and whining because of your suffering, because that is a fleshly obligation of doubt that God is not God. And God has been God the entire time. He has delivered us. He has been faithful to us. He has been committed to us. He has provided for us. Even when we murmured about not having meat, the Lord has delivered. Even when we were lost in sin, the Lord has delivered. So be confident in the Spirit that works and abides in you on God's behalf. If you have any way to walk like Jesus, and obligate yourself to do what the Spirit continues to tell you to do. Get the book of show that is in your house that gets wiped off when company comes by and start reading it. That's the Bible, y'all. You know how it looks good, but when you remove it, you can see the dust stain. Leave some chicken grease prints in it. Leave some bent pages in it and feed your spirit, because as soon as you seek, then He will open the door. You don't understand His ways because you don't read and you don't act like He does, because you don't read what He tells us to do. And the beginning of any action of the Lord is to turn to Him and be obligated to your eternal life. Don't store up no treasures here, because it's going to die. Is there anything more important than your eternal life? Maybe you need to ask yourself that. Is there anything in this world that you should be more obligated to than doing the work of the Lord? If you think so, I'm going to answer a couple statements for you. Not my mother. Not my father, my brother, my sister, my child, my grandchild, or anyone else should come before your obligation to the Lord. As a matter of fact, your obligation to the Lord is to tell them about Him. See, the same Spirit that raised Jesus, not a different one or a new one, but the same one that snatched Jesus from death is in you and will give this mortal and perishable body life. See, a life that we have to live here knowing who we are obligated to, and a life not to death, but an eternal life in glory. We are co-heirs to the kingdom. Can you imagine the inheritance of heaven? Can you imagine returning to perfection? I can somewhere, and I still can't fathom all of it. Who would love me enough to give me so much when I have fallen short so many times? But it will only happen when you see that there is no fleshly obligation. Step into walking with the Lord. He wants you with them or on the same great power that snatched Jesus from death would not be in you. He didn't just leave the Holy Spirit just to say, I left them. Keep believing and getting stronger. Tell non-believers about their true obligation. And know that there is no obligation for the flesh except death. And I only accept life. And that comes through my obligation to the Lord and His Spirit. Remember that the flesh does not want the Lord's ways, and we are not stuck in that state. There was a time when the Lord wasn't talking to us, and He was preparing for us. And when we were slaves to sin, and we couldn't do anything. But the Lord provided, so I'm not stuck in that state of sin to the flesh. The flesh says go against God, and we are not obligated to go against a loving God. And why would anyone want to go against love? A love that is more than the love that you have for yourself. A love that created you in His own image. A love that made a perfect place for you. And even when we didn't love Him back like we should, He still paid for us to be able to have the gift of salvation. See, if you are listening, then here is what you need to know. Our debt is not to the flesh. Stop going to it. Our debt is to the Lord. Now, I left verse 13 out of my passage intentionally. Because Romans 8 and 13 says, for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. It's simply saying, if you keep living in your own ways, you will not get to see your ways. You have to stop thinking that your way is the right way, because I have made so many left turns, ran so many stop signs, crashed and burned at every corner until I let the Lord start driving. And you probably in the same vehicle. You believe in the Lord, then let the Lord drive. You trust in the Lord, then let the Lord drive. If the Holy Spirit is in you, then let the Holy Spirit drive. This flesh wants you to die. And the flesh wants you to die twice. That spirit tells you, I got life after this life. Yeah, you're going to leave this body, but you're going to go from mortal to immortal. You're going to go from perishable to imperishable. See, I got something new for you. Something better for you, because you have not been obligated to the flesh. See, we walk in the fruit and not the axe. We know this. So get out of the darkness and stay in the light. If you are in the darkness, then ask the Lord to turn on your light. But please understand that you are not obligated to the flesh, because the flesh has never done anything for you. It cannot do anything for you. It will leave one day. But if you are obligated to the Spirit, you are looking at eternal life.
All right.
If you want to say it another way, you are looking at the eternal reward of God's love for you acting according to the Spirit. And how do I get there? By being obligated to the Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Great word. Great word. My goodness. Being obligated to the Spirit. My God. Great word, brother. Come on, Pastor Stevenson.
You know, we
like
we said, we obligated ourselves to get the back money and everything in the world. You got a job, you wake up early to get to that job. You get job your whole body.
Amen.
And I like what you said, that we'll put everything before God. Everything. Obligate ourselves to, oh, I got to do this, and then I'm going to do this. We always put God on the background. My God. We just start putting him on the front ground and let the way. Come on, Sister Freeman, I heard you.
Yeah. I just love that message, because being obligated to God is much more better to the Spirit rather than to the flesh. Because, like I say, the flesh can't offer you nothing.
Can't offer you a thing.
Not a thing. I'm telling you, that was a beautiful message.
Amen. Amen. For God, we take glory. Come on, Pastor. Give him the glass and you on. Yeah, Pastor McGrath. Come on, Dr. Hemp.
Amen.
Don't come up with
a new
post. But it's always State Farm, AAA, no insurance company you could name have the benefit.
Amen.
That the Lord have for you. May they benefit when we need on you. But God insurance and His benefit will take you all the way.
All right.
To eternal life. Amen. That's a great message, Pastor Lyle.
Amen. Amen.
Hey, where you saw that? Can he be on there? Come on, say something about that.
He on there, I think. He probably won't speak though. Booby, you on? Devin, you on? Is that what it is?
Bringing people in. You know what I'm saying?
Yep. we ought to help one another. We're not coming down on the take over, but we just think we can push him though. We're pushing off new territory so God can build up his kingdom.
Amen.
All right now. Amen. Well, there's nothing else. We're going to turn it back over to the hands of our speaker for today. Reverend Jeffrey Lyle. Come on, Pastor Lyle. Do your thing again, bro.
Just love y'all back. Definitely love y'all back. Some things I really want us to think about. We say we go to church on Sunday and whatever you want to call it. But we need to concentrate on God every day. You can get in your car and put on a gospel song and give God some time. He'll fill you up for the day with a gospel song. You can say a verse out loud in your car, in your home, at work. He'll help you. But if you are just trying to get one moment to carry you through the week, it ain't gonna work. Because Satan be in all those other moments. And that is truly the flesh telling you, don't call on him. If you notice, I said call on him in the good times because he already done delivered you. Well, knowing that he will deliver you should give you a reason to call on him at any time. So understand that the world is going to be against God, and they want you to be obligated to this flesh, this material, what you can see and sense in your five senses, but God works in the unseen.
Yes.
And you got to be strong enough to look for the unseen. You may not see it, but you will receive it if you keep staying obligated to the Spirit. And if you don't believe me, you can look at Hebrews 11. And you can see where they didn't get to see it, but they died in their faith and they will see it. God makes that a promise. And that same Holy Spirit that was there for Abraham and Jesus and Peter and Paul is the same Holy Spirit that he left here for us. So as Pastor Jimmy was saying, take advantage of your benefits because ain't nobody got a better package than the Lord. Amen? Pastor Jimmy, you want to pray us out, brother?
Yeah.